Klaas? Hello everyone, welcome to the first session of Temperature Check, the making of a biennial where art is center stage. My name is Mohammed Salemi. I'm the operator slash coordinator of these sessions. Our instructors for this seminar are Maria Lin, together with her curatorial team from the Guangzhou Biennial, Bina Choi, Azar Mahmoudian, Margarita Mendez, Michelle Wong, and we will be having several guests throughout the sessions. The first guest tonight is Tyler Coburn. I'm going to pass on the camera to Margarita to start.
So, hello, I'm going to do the small introduction on the biennial, and then we can continue with the introductions we were doing and take it from there with Tyler's presentation, followed by a Q&A and long discussion. So, The Eighth Climate, What Does Art Do? Is the title of the Guangzhou Biennial 2016, which has his team, five curatorial members, as Mo described, and as well the curatorial associate in Guangzhou Mitte Ugru, a project space based in the city existing since, I think, 5 years. So What Does Art Do? Tries to reflect on the performative, the projective, and the imaginative qualities of arts, with a strong focus on the future, what's art's capacity to say something about the future, and also on mediation, something we'll be discussing over the 8 sessions that the artist and curatorial duos will lead on this course. This biennial tries to have an embedded focus on its locality, on the peripheral quality of the city of Guangzhou, but nonetheless have a strong international outreach trying to connecting dots between many small and medium-scale institutions and individual practitioners across the world that share concerns. So it will have a system of fellows, of which the new Center for Research and Practice is obviously one, as well as many other institutions that will be in contact and keep doing their work exactly as they do, but be affirmed as colleagues in solidarity sharing the same concerns over their practice. But as well, this biennial, which does not have a theme but has many areas of interest and focus, is composed of other activities. Whilst trying to place art at center stage, it has many small poles of curatorial activities, such as, for example, the monthly gatherings, which are happening monthly with the collaboration of Mitte Ugru Project Space and includes a series of artist presentations, screenings, reading group, group critiques, curated walks. Another component is the infra-school program, of which this course that we are having here today, the first session, takes part in. And the infra-school has circa 8 partners across the world, in Guangzhou, Seoul, and online, where a lot of lectures and courses will take place. But as well, there will be other events related with the biennial, such as a forum on the opening days, the first days of September, in case you are in Asia. You're very welcome to join. It will be from the 2nd to the 4th of September. Of course, the exhibition, which starts on the 1st.
I just wanted to say that we're in conversation, and New Center might take part in the forum or be involved somehow, according to
how
the
very good.
And how we develop this.
We're very happy with that collaboration. And yeah, I think I've spoken enough of this brief outline. I'm not going to go into much depth, but Maria will join us on the future sessions and we can start unleashing some of the concerns. But placing art as a center stage is, of course, the main aim. And that's why we decided that this course on curating and mediation should be strongly focused on artist presentations, and we decide to split this course both in reading groups. And this presentation, which today we have Tyler Coburn with us. And next week we'll be debating a text that I'm going to send afterwards. And yeah, maybe I pass the word to you, Tyler.
Okay.
Or maybe we do the rest of the introductions.
Yeah. I think that would be great. I'll give a short introduction, and then maybe we can continue the rest.
Exactly.
I'm very happy to be here as well, and to meet you all virtually. My guilty confession is that this is my first Google Hangout, so all of this is a little overwhelming, somewhat exciting. I'm an artist based in New York. I also have a writing practice, and I'm a professor at a few universities, at the New School and the Art Institute of Chicago and Pratt and City College. So it's really nice to, among other things, see how different models of online pedagogy are being conceived, because one of the things I do at the Art Institute is teach online classes for a low residency master's program. So today I'm going to be talking about three different projects I've worked on in the last 5 or so years, and that will last about an hour, hour and 15 minutes. But before going on to that, it would be great to get to know the rest of you. Thanks. Does somebody else want to introduce? So
who wants to go next? Jesse, you. You're quiet. Okay,
I can't hear anything.
Why don't we go to somebody else? Maybe you leave and come back and quit your browser and quit and restart. And then, okay, what about Santiago? Do you want to go first? Because I heard you speak earlier on.
Yeah. Does everybody listen?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Well, my name is Santiago Piñol. I'm an artist based in Bogota, Colombia. This is my second seminar on the new center. And when I was thinking about joining the seminar, I started to Google things around Maria Lin, and I end up reading an interview between her and Jens Hoffman. And I really liked because they were almost fighting between two ways of curating, because between a very, very classical way, even conservative, and the other way that was proposed by Maria as a methodology. And I really like that idea of curating. I think it relates to the type of work that we're doing here in Bogota. I'm part of an office for art projects that called La Agencia. And we have a project that's called Garage School, Escuela de Garaje. And it's a project based on art and education territory. And especially, yes, we've been dealing with curatorial formats. So I really like what I read. So I am very happy to be here.
Maybe share with us later the names of these institutions on the sidebar so I copy it into the classroom if somebody wants to look it up later.
Yes, yes. Sorry, the web pages are completely in Spanish. We haven't translated that, but I'll share them on the chat.
I know the project space. It's very nice. I met one of your members. I've been following the program.
Jesse, do you want to see if it works? It doesn't work. Maybe you have an app that's kind of like, try it one more time. We're going to switch to Dylan for now. Dylan.
Hey, I've already gone once, but I'll just quickly say that.
Go to the video, you know.
Yeah, hey, video. I'm an artist. I'll be starting an MFA at UC Santa Cruz in the fall. And I'm excited to be here and learn some stuff, hear your presentation. Okay.
And Olivia kind of like spoke about, do you want to just like say something for the tape?
Yeah, I can repeat. I'm an artist. I'm from New York, but I'm based in LA right now. Yeah, I'm interested also in questions of what art can do and methods of abstraction in my own practice. And,
I want to ask you something. The interpassivity came up. What kind of interest Tyler has in interpassivity? That conversation, like briefly, I came in late. I didn't understand. You brought up Tyler's name in relation to interpassivity.
Yeah, no, I read your essay, A Wide Blank, and it was Disc Magazine, right? No, it was really formative in thinking about this concept of interpassivity and relating it to my own experiences. So I'd love to talk to you about that later. I kind of continued upon it and kind of related it to ideas of like emotional labor in the workplace and hyperemployment and
Did Tyler quote Zizek or no?
Yes.
Okay. Well, funny, because your name, this is what I was trying to do, because your name came up last night in the dinner too, because this artist who just completing a PhD in practice, Patricia Reyes, she's from Portugal, and she brought up your name in relation to interpassivity, because she's also kind of like doing something, Tyler's name, and I brought up your name, Olivia. So I have to put you guys in touch. She's doing her PhD presentation next week, and I'll just do a studio visit with her. She's making really amazing work. But let's see if we can get Jesse.
Can you write her name on the sidebar, Mohammed?
Yes, I'm going to actually write it on the sidebar.
Thank you.
Jesse, your microphone is just not working. it's a drag, but I don't know what's going on. Avon,
what?
She can always type on the side, but I'm sure Avon's microphone works.
I think it worked. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm Avon Kang. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm excited about this. Unfortunately, this might be my only time that I can make it live to the seminar, because it's on a Tuesday. But I certainly would like to follow along. And actually, if it's 8 weeks, I could probably come back during the last couple weeks. So I'm just here to kind of observe, and I have taken several other seminars at the New Center, and they've all been completely mind-blowing. So when I heard that this one was around the Gwangju Biennale, I felt like, you know, really interested, because I'm also I've studied a bit of the background of that city, but the political history there, the Gwangju Uprising, and I was wondering if anybody can connect the dots between contemporary art and that kind of legacy, it would be right here. So I'm very excited about that prospect. And yeah, that's... Oh, like he said, I'm a composer, a musician, and I teach at CalArts. So I'm based in LA at the moment.
Just on a small note, our students still are learning how to like kind of like promote themselves. Dylan, Avon, and Olivia all three participated in the Super Conversations project last summer, and did several responses to the E-Flux Super Community pieces. And you can find their work in the Super Conversation and Super Community website that the E-Flux created. Avon composed a piece of music as a response. Actually, Jesse did several of them too. So their work is kind of like there. If you guys are interested in see what kind of like thinking they do, and Olivia also did an art piece as one of the responses. If I remember, it was like a flowchart, right, Olivia? But also some text, right? You did more than one response. Dylan did a few writings, really, really nice. Dylan's got a very sharp pen, and if he ever like gets his like stuff together and writes, he's an amazing writer. Yeah. So, Jesse, do you want to try maybe one more time? This is the last try, and otherwise you just have to type it on the sidebar. I don't think it's working. So sorry. It requires a total like computer startup. But anyways, I'm really sorry. Okay, Tyler, why don't we start with you? Go ahead.
Okay. So I have a PowerPoint to present, so I'll share that. At 2 points in the PowerPoint, I have video to show, and we decided the best way to show it is for me to provide the links for you and for everybody to just take a few minutes to to watch the clips. They're all available online. So I'll let you know when those things are coming up. Let me just cue the right slide for the PowerPoint. One second. Okay. Are people seeing a black screen?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Also, if anything comes up while I'm speaking, any technical issues, or if there are any sort of pressing questions or you need immediate clarification, feel free to enter into conversation. But I'm also happy to talk at length, of course, in the Q&A afterwards. So as I mentioned, I'm going to be sharing three artworks I've made in the last 5 years or so. As an introduction, by and large, my work is very research-oriented. So usually I'll begin with a topic that I'm curious to learn more about. As I build a world of research and come to understand its logics, I gain a sense of the possibilities of how I might give this research form. So this makes my practice highly interdisciplinary, and in recent years I've worked in publishing, furniture making, video, performance, web design, and so on. Nonetheless, there are themes and concerns that run throughout my projects. In particular, I'm exploring the material infrastructure and byproducts of contemporary technology. I'm also looking at emerging forms of labor within digital and techno-urban space. There are also broader questions. What does uncreative or creative writing look like in the 21st century? How can an artwork in its form acknowledge or perform the complexities of our technological and geopolitical networks? Finally, how do we understand enduring notions of subjectivity and the self within the context of post-human discourse? So obviously, these are very big questions. And to ground them, I'll start talking about my projects. The first one is called I Met Angel. And it's an ongoing project that comprises four parts: a book, a reader, a data center, and a tour of a data center. I Met Angel is written from the perspective of a content farmer. So before I go any further, I'll tell you a bit about that industry. A content farm is an online news organization that attempts to generate articles based on trending topics. Here we have the logo of Associated Content, which came into being in 2005 and later became Yahoo Voices. In its heyday, this farm used robots to scan websites like Google Trends and generate relevant article prompts, which could be claimed and written by its content farmers, sometimes with as short a turnaround as 30 minutes. At its peak, Associated Content published 10,000 pieces of content a week. Now, it's true that there's a human on either end of a content-farmed article, but that should not make us mistake the basic economic purpose of the form. These articles are being written to game search engine algorithms. They deploy trending language to ensure higher search rankings. The articles thus get more clicks, their advertisers more eyeballs, to use industry parlance, every eyeball another few cents, and so on and so forth. Let me move on to another example. This is the current main page of Demand Media, which was created in 2006. I don't want to dwell on this image, but just let me note that this is an image of a mother turning her daughter into a robot. So one thing to note about this ad is its target audience, as stay-at-home moms make up a large percentage of American content farmers, including my sister. So Demand Media is a consortium that includes websites like eHow and LiveStrong. In 2009, the company was projected to be publishing 1 million items a month. Rumor had it that Demand was so profitable that it would put major news journals like the New York Times out of business. As of 2010, Demand was the 17th largest web property in the United States and the first content farm to go public. Now, content farms have received a fair amount of criticism for lowering the quality of searches on platforms like Google, bringing users to lesser quality articles. They've been described as the fast food chains of the information superhighway, and the reputation of search engines began to suffer by proxy. One response came in the form of Google Panda, a more robust search engine algorithm the company introduced in 2011. The improvements were designed to lower the search rank of thin, low-quality sites, thus directly targeting the stuff coming out of the farms. Since then, content farms have continued to proliferate. These are some of the more ridiculous logos I could find. But in general, Google Panda has had a substantial effect on the industry. The effects have been palpable. Demand media sites lost about a quarter of their traffic overnight, and its stock crashed and stayed down. Yahoo Voices, the inheritor of associated content, shut down in the summer of 2014, sending regular contributors scrambling. The era of the big content farms has come to a close, and businesses are quickly developing new techniques for disseminating content, which are increasingly reliant on social media sharing or share baiting. So in the interest of full disclosure, I once worked as a content farmer, albeit on a very small scale. In the year after college, as I juggled various low-paying jobs, I was hired to generate articles about kitchen cleaning tips, dust mite prevention, the best ways for young mothers to organize their daily tasks, writing from great personal experience, obviously. With I'm That Angel, I wanted to think about the content farmer, this member of the creative class in pursuit of the self-liberation and creative entrepreneurship promised by post-fordist rhetoric, this person who finds her work on the side to be a wholly industrialized form of online production, who believes in millennial myths despite all evidence to the contrary. I spent some time in online forums with other content writers, and one commonly hears the same stories. Most of them also work part or full-time jobs, but are keen to pursue their true passion of writing. Content farms thus provide the room to hone their skills and generate cuttings. Few of these aspiring writers view the farms as a primary revenue stream. Demand Media happens to be one of the best remunerators in the field, paying $15 an article. Several other farms pay an entry-level fee of a cent per word, which can increase to 5 cents after a certain number of contributions. Content farms, in short, are a means to a different end. Yet many of the farmers write for companies that don't provide bylines for articles, preventing writers from using them as formal cuttings. Given the trying times the industry is facing, farms have been known to close sites and slash pay without warning. Their freelancers can either consent to the changes or leave. And some farmers just burn out, pure and simple. Others attempt to take action. To give an example, in 2011, AOL bought the Huffington Post for $315 million, turning the political blog into an advertising-financed operation. Jonathan Tessini, shown on the left, who had contributed 216 unpaid articles to the blog, filed a $105 million class action suit on behalf of himself and 9,000 other unpaid bloggers, arguing that they deserved a cut. The case ended up being dismissed on the grounds that these writers were never working under the expectation of being paid. Their article, in short, was baseless. Arianna Huffington gave a similar defense, she's on the right, adding that personal passion and cultural capital were sufficient motivators for her writers. There are other cases I could cite, aimed at Yelp and Crowdflower, for example. Each is negotiating the specific terms of a given web platform, yet they all raise the basic question about the labor rights of digital content generators, a question that certainly extends to content farmers. Now, many of us experience these labor conditions in our professional and online lives. The content farmer, as such, is not an exceptional case, but an exemplary one for considering different theories of the informational age. How in what Jody Dean calls communicative capitalism, we have a political economic formation where there's talk without response, where messages are made to be circulated, not to generate dialogue, and where content, as the circulationist form par excellence, replaces discourse. How human communication, according to Paolo Verno, has gone beyond being a mere commodity to become the quintessence of the mode of productivity. Building on this, how to Michael Hart, the elevation of human communication to the mode of productivity is such that other aspects of human relations, their affective dimensions, can assume dominant positions within the contemporary informational economy. As an instrument, affect has been used in the service of naturalizing emerging forms of labor and sociality, of giving the figures but hiding the ground. The content farm is one site where we can see this in action. Articles are ostensibly pitched to populist interest, empowering their aspiring writers and edifying online readers with celebrity top 10 guides and how-to guides. The thin but necessary veneer we maintain is that we are humans, are welcomed into cyberspace in our full capacity as humans. It's true that this may all be a front for a game of economics played by robots and search engines and advertisers. But if we have a role, let it be more than an eyeball. Let our online participation deliver us into a future that's more than monetizable. We know we're eyeballs, but still. In one of his cattiest moments, American novelist Truman Capote characterized the work of Jack Kerouac by remarking, "That's not writing, that's typing." We can only imagine what Capote would think of writing on the internet. The Content Farmer also interests me for the questions it raises on this front, for what we do when we recognize that we're writing less for humans than for algorithmic capture, that our words will mean more to the Google robot than to anyone else. To American conceptual poet Kenneth Goldsmith, we're quickly adapting to the currents of the online world, growing less and less like the readers of language than the parsers of text. In attempting to keep up with the informational demand, we sort through language much like a robot reader. In the not-too-distant future, Goldsmith's account goes, we give up this John Henry narrative. We're already writing more for machines than humans, and our machines are also doing quite a bit of their own farming and writing. So why not just let them do all the work? This is a question Canadian poet Christian Bach directs to the field of poetry. In a somewhat tongue-in-cheek formulation, Bach asks, why hire a poet to write a poem when the poem can in fact write itself? These poems of the future, to Goldsmith, might be best not to read at all. They may be better to think about. So here we have a familiar endgame. Whether we're dealing with poetic, artistic, or other labor, technology can decrease our working lives and increase the time for personal reflection. This endgame makes a gamble on the future that will benefit from ceding more control to machines. Yet somewhere in the theory I detect a creeping fatalism, a concern that we may not have much choice in the matter. I wrote I'm That Angel in response to this endgame, and from a belief in the critical necessity to not merely make do with our given online roles, nor abandon them wholesale, but find ways to put them in the service of continuing to imagine forms of subjectivity and sociality. Content farming establishes two parameters, a necessary quota of trending language, an article of sufficient length and quality. So I wondered, with limited editorial oversight, to what other use could a content-farmed article be put? Could one claim the linguistic space around the quotas, the spans between buzzwords? Could a memoir be written by a farmer who smuggles the self into industrialized writing? So to give an example, this is the moment when I'd like you all to take a look at this link, which I'm going to post right now. It's about an 8.5-minute video. So take some time with it, and maybe once you've returned, you can just post in the right chat bar that you're ready to resume.
Tyler, yes. I have a question. Is the video YouTube?
It's Vimeo.
It's Vimeo, because the YouTube app here is not a bad, it works well, but only with YouTube, actually. I don't know how the Vimeo works, but because, you know, on the sidebar, you can post the YouTube link, and then everybody will see it, but they see it, like, not, like, as broadcasted, so, but forget it, it's Vimeo, so it will be fine if you just give us a which you just did.
Okay. Great. So I'll see you all in about 8 minutes.
8 minutes.
Or so.
So I'm back.
Okay, great. Should I continue?
Well, let's see.
Everybody here?
I finished watching, but I'm maybe a little bit fast. Is everybody here? If you're here, just say you're here.
I guess okay.
Taking a couple of more minutes, but we can discuss it if you turn your camera on, because you know people we can like watch the video. Avin is back and Dylan is also back. So if you turn your camera on, it'd be nice to chat with you.
So a bit of context about what you were watching. I should have provided it before giving the link. That was footage that I shot at the Google building in New York in the spring of 2013. And the person reading is an actor called Justin Sayer. The way that the event works, and I'm going to go on to talk more about it in my formal talk, but the way the event always works is that I develop a relationship with a data center, and we organize an event where the first part of the event is a reading that takes place in a conference room or available facility. If the room has 10 seats, 10 existing seats, 9 people can come. If it has 20 existing seats, 19 people can come. So they're very intimate events, and it's very important to adapt the audience to the conditions of the site, not turn the data center into some type of spectacle space. The reading itself is about 35 minutes. And then following the reading is a tour of all of the facilities, which is always conducted by somebody who works at the data center itself. And I've done about, let's say, 12 or 13 of these now. I mean, in different data centers, that is, primarily in Europe and the U.S. But the events are never documented. If the audience is allowed to take photographs on the tour, then they end up producing the documentation of the tour itself. But the readings themselves really aren't. So this is an extenuating circumstance. I had a lot of access to this facility in the Google building, which was a new data center that was being built. It's now entirely filled, but at the time there was just that one server, which was the model server and also was storing the company's information. So at that point I made a two-channel video to have a document of the thing, but normally when the events happen, there is not a camera in the room. So Justin read the first two times I did the event in LA and New York, and since then, because of just the economics of traveling the project, I normally do the readings. So that's some background about it.
Justin is an actor, right, that you hired, or he's a collaborator and friend?
I met him through some art friends, actually. He's actually been in some of Liz Magic Laser's work as well. He's a radical fairy. He's a playwright, in addition to being an actor. I really wanted somebody, because the book itself, as you can see if you look at that PDF that I sent on the right column, the book doesn't immediately suggest how it should be read. there's very little punctuation, and it's a bit frenetic and scatological. So I wanted to work with an actor who had his own sense of how the text might be read, who heard it in a different way than I did. I thought that would produce a more interesting dialogue. And I wanted to work with somebody who also had experience working with actors, because it was new to me. So to a certain extent, Justin was also his own director. And the way that I read the text now is partly based on all of the rehearsing that we did to even get him to learn how to read it. So there's a sort of strange triangulation of voices in the reading between the voice on the page and Justin and myself.
So the text doesn't change. It's the same text.
Yeah, and he only reads the central column of about the first 30 pages of the book. So all of the sort of paraliterary Talmudic citational stuff going around the central column is not performed in the text itself. Originally, the entire book was read. It was written to be this sort of like total performance object, and the third section of the book has the character actually working as a data server. But it was just so fucking long. And also, very interesting things started to happen on the tours that I hadn't anticipated, the way that audiences and tour guides would really negotiate the situation. And it felt like a shame to cut that short, to have to limit that time. So I ended up restructuring the event to let the tour be this open-ended second part of the event. Does anybody have any other questions before I continue to talk about the project?
Yeah. I actually was wondering, you mentioned kind of writing around the quotas. Mm-hmm. You know, if you could kind of smuggle something in. I'm wondering how much of that idea went into this PDF, or if you made any attempts at actually, you know, publishing online in this sort of sneaky way, or how you negotiated that idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, in the text itself, there are moments of sort of like interruption, especially in the first 30 pages when the character is primarily doing this work of what seem like just sort of like trending language, right? Where it seems like there's some type of metric that has to be met. So it's not so insistent. It's not, let's say, in the purest sense of a content-farmed article, like every other word, you know, as a trending word. But nonetheless, like it's trying to stage some type of, to stage that conflict or that negotiation between the demand of performing a certain type of necessary language and writing what one wants, trying to perform that within at least the central column of the text.
So this way, the text is sort of like a separate but integral element to the artwork. It's not just the performance or the video, because you need the text,
mm-hmm.
the book, to need to get what actually the whole thing is about.
Exactly. I mean, one of the reference points for, I mean, there are a few reference points for the project, but one of them is like, you know, Mallarmé's massive unfinished book project, which some of you might be familiar with. And, you know, the idea with that text is that it's not structured, so it doesn't immediately imply how it's supposed to be read, but it's also a text that needs to be performed, that demands performance. And Mallarmé writes about his ideal performance scenarios. I mean, those are really like seance, like almost, like the text in performing it, one is conjuring the language off of the page. But I was very interested in the idea of language being in a latent state on the page, you know, that it's not just reading a book, you know, but actually that the text has a certain oral principle that needs to be activated. But then at the same time, partly going off of what Mohammed was saying, the experience of listening to the thing is partial in a certain way, much as the experience of reading the thing without attending the event is partial in another way. So there's no sort of like, you know, there's no central site of the work. It's very distributed in its make. Should I continue? Or okay.
Because you might be answering questions that people might ask, so why don't we just like listen to you?
Sorry?
I'm saying like you might already be explaining or answering the question, so why don't you just...
Okay, certainly. And I should say, you know, because I'm talking about three works, if it's helpful for me to stop after each project and just check in, I'm happy to also see if there are any pressing questions. So after I finish talking about this one, we can check in again. So, let's see. All right. So I wanted to now transition away from content farming and some of these questions about writing and start talking a bit about the physical internet, because obviously that's a big part of this project as well. So by way of doing so, I wanted to share a joke. So in his 2005 address to the graduating class of Kenyon College, David Foster Wallace tells the following story. There are these two young fish swimming along, and they happen to meet an older fish swimming the other way, who nods at them and says, "Morning, boys, how's the water?" And the two young fish swim on for a bit, and then eventually one of them looks over at the other and goes, "What the hell is water?" So at the time I began writing this book, the cloud was entering common parlance, and I frequently had the experience of hearing friends use the term, only to then say, "Well, I don't know what the cloud means, but I know that we're supposed to say it." I lived through many generations of digital technology, but this transition stood out, perhaps for how a diffuse, natural form could become a diffuse, naturalized metaphor, for how a symbol could come to operate without needing to clarify what it actually stood for. Some of us may have suffered a similar anxiety back in the day, but most of us now know that the cloud denotes thin devices and remote data storage underpinned by the massive infrastructure of the physical internet. So in this sense, the cloud is an inaccurate metaphor, as our cloud is tethered to the earth like a balloon, though it's understandable why the internet was made into a heavenly body and not a flimsy piece of man-made rubber. I'm That Angel, as I mentioned, is a book made to be read aloud in data centers. I designed it this way because I felt compelled to demystify our floating metaphor, to pin it down and open it up, to bring people inside the server halls where many of us already exist, to stage a re-encounter between oneself and one's physical data, to chant, like a mantra, this is water, this is water. So as I mentioned, I've staged about a dozen events in data centers in Europe and the United States, bringing small audiences in for readings and facility tours conducted by data center personnel. These events change with every venue, with a given company, and with what guests bring to the conversation. So in the next few minutes, I'd like to briefly share a few notable stops. This is the Pionen White Mountains facility in Stockholm, located in a former civil defense center. The name of the center is somewhat of an exaggeration, as Pionen is not in the mountains, but beneath an elevated park on a residential street in a city. Not very secretive and not very remote. So this site is famous for two things. First, when it was turned into a data center in 2008, the company decided to style it in the manner of a James Bond villain's lair. Two, if you're in need of a data haven to store your questionable content, look no further than Pionen, which has historically benefited from Sweden's strong freedom of speech and information laws. Past and current clients at Pionen include the North American Man-Boy Love Association and PRQ, a company that hosted the Pirate Bay and WikiLeaks. Oh, sorry about that. What am I doing? I'm actually operating two versions of the slideshow at the same time, which is why this is getting confusing. As the story goes, WikiLeaks was kicked off of Amazon's data servers in 2010 and began storing its content here. The famous 2010 WikiLeaks releases came from two servers at Pionen, including this one, which the company chairman proceeded to auction off for the benefit of Reporters Without Borders, but not before taking a series of brooding photographs with them. There are about 12 images like this on their website that you can freely download. In Glasgow, I read in a small data center that was run like an episode of The Office. One of the staffers admitted that the data center industry was fairly humdrum, and when she and her coworkers get bored, they pull pranks or make cakes that look like server racks. Case in point. An amusing thing happened with my event here. One of the staff pitched an article to Data Center Solutions magazine, which for those not in the know is like the art forum of the data center industry. So the first night I arrived to do a reading, we had a photo shoot. First, they put me and the CEO up on a shipping pallet covered with old computer servers. I'm trying to look as uncomfortable as possible. And then we posed for this shot. So this may be the single best piece of evidence I have that I actually have been in a data center. And of course, we look like cardboard cutouts photoshopped onto a stock backdrop. My visit to Google Zurich was less for its data center, which just stores the information of the campus, and more for the opportunity to see one of the most extravagant creative offices in the world. Google Zurich, for reference, is the engineering headquarters of the company outside of the United States, and its engineers have worked on Google Maps, Search, Gmail, Calendar, YouTube, and so on. But Google Zurich is better known as the place where work is recast as relaxation, bounty, play, where engineers can choose their optimal work climate and elevation. Can schedule a meeting in a parachute basket or a mountain gondola, given that they are in Switzerland. I performed over two nights at Google, and on both tours, a very enthusiastic engineer took us to every single themed room, into every quirky nook and cranny the campus had to offer. The aquarium filled with lounge chairs and bathtubs for relaxation. The supermarket wallpapered with an image of products that you could scan to order. The beauty of the service, the engineer remarked, is that one never has to leave the office to run errands or get dinner. One can just keep working, even the whole night through. At this point on the tour, some of my guests accused me of hiring an actor to play a Google engineer. Could a Google employee truly be so enthusiastic and unreflective about his work situation? And indeed, I know many people who work at Google who have very nuanced relationships to their employer. In our case, this tour guide was performative, but he was no actor. Tensions on the tour finally came to a head in the 20% room, which is shown here. It's designed to look like an underground bunker. Google famously allows an employee to devote 20% of his or her working time to a passion project. Workers are empowered to pursue their engineering passions, and the products remain within the proprietary domain of the company. Let me give you a sense of how much Google has benefited from this 20% policy. The services created during this personal time include Gmail, Google News, the autocomplete function, and AdSense, which accounts for roughly a quarter of Google's revenues. At this point, some of my guests attempted to call out the exploitative nature of this structure, and for the first time, things with our tour guide got hostile. But within minutes, we were sliding down to the cafeteria. One last example. I arrived in Haarlem in the Netherlands to read at this data center. Upon meeting me, the press liaison told me she had read my book. She remarked, "You must be very smart or very stupid, and I have no idea which. It was the best thing anyone has ever said about the book." Our tour guide here was of a very different stripe than the Google engineer. He's the sort of man who flies to conferences on cloud security, who knows his way around the discourse. At the end of the tour, one of the guests asked our guide what the future of the internet looks like, and for the next few minutes, I'll share his remarks. He cited a 2012 UN conference on telecommunications governance, attended by representatives of most of the world's countries. The debate revealed a sharp division of opinion in the role a nation should play, with America and the EU supporting internet freedoms, and China, Russia, Saudi Arabia, and others preferring strong, even authoritarian, limits on internet access. In the wake of the Snowden revelations, we know this division isn't as sharp as previously thought, and that the United States' relationship to telecommunications governance may be authoritarian by another name. The United States' super jurisdiction, which is a term that Metahaven has used, extends well beyond affordances allowed by and since the Patriot Act, allowing the government to search and seize data within its territory, as well as from any cloud service that conducts business with the United States, no matter its physical location. We've since seen a partitioning of the cloud, of France and Canada, the governments of France and Canada, taking precautions against their governmental data being routed through US servers, of the rise of securitized private clouds in countries like Switzerland and Luxembourg, which protect your data at considerable cost. In some cases, this partitioning can play to the advantage of free internet advocates. Metahaven gives Iceland as an example of a country that has turned its legal sovereignty, real-world isolation, and global connectedness into solid bases for a new experiment with internet democracy. Nonetheless, our tour guide was fairly pessimistic, seeing the future as one in which governments attempt to enforce greater network controls in the name of protecting civil liberties, perhaps even going so far as to solicit cyber terrorist attacks as justification for increasing security. Cyber terrorism can take many forms. You can cut an undersea cable or set off a bomb in the American Northwest, but the greatest threats to the internet, he told us, come through the lines, through online warfare. Cables, after all, can be mended or relayed. Servers might have remote backups. The network, in short, is far too complex for the only struggle to play out in physical space. Ever since that tour, I've been turning over the tour guide's words because they raise a question that's also pertinent to my project. When no single data center can embody or stand in for the whole, what can we do with this site? Why visit this site? Even this many years into the project, I wouldn't claim to have answers. In the spirit of James Lee Byers, I'm just looking for questions. And the experience of bringing an audience and data center staff together is each and every time a question, new, different, and enduring. Standing in a data center and recognizing its incapacity to embody or stand in for the whole, being given access to a transparent view yet leaving with the feeling that things are more opaque than you ever imagined, turning the data center into a platform for a discussion about energy, security, politics, and subjectivity. These are not nothings, not just grist for the algorithmic mill. In general, I found that these events serve as reminders of what Mark Andreevich calls the knowledge asymmetry of the big data era, the divide between those who generate data and those who instrumentalize it, but also an infrastructural divide shaped by ownership and control of the material resources for data storage and mining. While my events don't structurally change this asymmetry, they're motivated by a belief that we have a claim in these centers, much as these data centers, as custodians of the internet, already have a claim in us. So those are some words about the project. I could go on to talk about the next thing, but if anybody has any questions at the moment, I'm happy to field them.
I would like to ask questions, but I think maybe it's better to just wait for you to go through the other ones.
Okay.
I think so too. Let's right. continue and then sum
that's,
up.
That's absolutely fine. So the second project I'm going to talk about is an essay, which is called Charter Citizen. In the fall of 2014, two very different thinkers came together to speak in New York. Peter Thiel on the left, a famous techno-libertarian and Silicon Valley angel investor, and David Graeber on the right, an anthropologist best known for his book, Debt, the First 5,000 Years. The two could not be further apart in their politics, yet both share what we might call a nostalgia for the future, a sense that for all our thin screens and vacuum robots, we're lagging behind the dreams of futures past. Graeber had previously voiced these concerns in his essay, Of Flying Cars and the Declining Rate of Profit, in which he poignantly asked, where are the flying cars? Where are the force fields, tractor beams, teleportation pods, anti-gravity sleds, tricorders, immortality drugs, colonies on Mars, and all of the other technological wonders any child growing up in the mid to late 20th century assumed would exist by now? In his essay, Graeber dispels the assumption that capitalism is in its nature technologically progressive and that it's an enemy of bureaucracy. In Graeber's opinion, neoliberalism is marked by the dominance of conservative managerial elites, corporate bureaucrats who use the pretext of short-term, competitive, bottom-line thinking to squelch anything likely to have revolutionary impact of any kind. Given this, we've not seen the emergence of revolutionary technologies, but only those most conducive to surveillance, work discipline, and social control. For example, the informational technologies that certainly have not freed our labor time, but reallocated and reintensified it. We've also seen various forms of corporate privatization and the suppression of innovation in technological, medical, and other sectors for fear of their economic effects. And yet the rhetoric of innovation characterizes our age. To Graeber, this can be explained by how neoliberalism saddles itself to technological determinism. Their respective narratives reinforce one another, foreclosing the possibility of any alternative form of technological futurity and of any alternative to capitalism. The paradox, in short, is that for neoliberalism to assert its victory over the present, it must also colonize the future. To ensure that innovations never exceed its bounds, it must scale progress to manageable outcomes. Now, Peter Thiel is best known as the co-founder of PayPal, and the man who gave the initial startup funds to Facebook. Yet he agrees with Graeber that the bureaucratic nature of corporate capitalism has hindered innovation. His famous remark is, "We wanted flying cars, instead we got 140 characters." As you might imagine, that's pretty much the beginning and end of these two men's agreement. Thiel is a self-described political atheist who famously wrote that he no longer believed that freedom and democracy are compatible. The great task for libertarians, in his opinion, is to find an escape from politics in all its forms. So I've dwelled on this event in part because both men have acted on their dissatisfaction. Graeber has been involved in Occupy, among other things, and Thiel has been active in giving $500,000 of startup funds to the Seasteading Institute, which is run by Milton Friedman's grandson, Patry, who's on the right. So for reference, this is the same amount of money that he gave Facebook in startup funds. The Seasteading Institute ostensibly is an attempt to build floating urban colonies in international waters, and the endeavor is largely supported by Silicon Valley capital. I learned about the Institute when I was writing and researching I'm That Angel. My research into data centers led me to investigate the internet's other geographical and geopolitical effects, and Patry's efforts to build seasteads in related cities in Honduras seemed worth considering as case studies for techno-libertarian futurity. So this is a USB business card that I was given when I attended the Seasteading Institute's 2012 conference in San Francisco. If you want to hear some weird stories from that weekend, I can email with you about them later. But as a teaser, here are some renderings from a Seasted design competition. You can live on this in the future. The Seasteading Institute is not an unprecedented phenomenon. Libertarians have long attempted to build tax and political havens, and I'll briefly discuss some of the more consequential examples. There's the story of Vegas real estate millionaire Michael Oliver. Oliver made a dozen failed attempts to buy off parts of other nations, and he eventually dredged up the usable land between the Minerva Reefs in 1972 to found the Republic of Minerva. Citing an established claim over a non-adjoining underwater site, the King of Tonga, with one gunboat, ended this republic. On the bottom right is Oliver's 1993 incarnation, the Atlantis Project, which abandoned diplomacy wholesale in favor of a proposed floating sea city called Oceania. Oliver's other venture, the Phoenix Foundation, financed insurrections in the Abacos and on Vanuatu between 1973 and 1980 with the hope of establishing autonomous enclaves. Here we have Doug Casey, best known as the author of the 1979 book Crisis Investing. Casey leveraged his investment gains to secure meetings with the heads of Dominican Republic, Suriname, Haiti, and in his words, a half dozen similar basket cases. He came with a pitch to privatize and trade these countries in their entirety on the New York Stock Exchange. Casey's half-baked plan would eliminate all taxes and regulations and distribute 70% of the country's shares, pro rata, to its citizens. The remainder would go into a generational trust, into world markets, and into the coffers of the masterminds. Let me give some historical legs to these endeavors. In each case, there's a primary goal of disentangling from the nation-state, which libertarians commonly see as a compulsory political form, what one is born into, not what one chooses. As Murray Rothbard writes, the nation-state promotes the value of the collective good as ideological camouflage for its predation through force, expropriation, and taxation. What you're looking at here is an image of the Peace of Westphalia in 1648. Which ended the 30 and 80 years wars between the Spanish and the Dutch, initiating a new system of political order in Central Europe based on the concept of a sovereign state. Libertarians thus attempt to provide a historical counter-narrative to Westphalia, one that questions the continuing relevance of the nation-state as a political and territorial form. One frequently cited example is the Hanseatic League, which existed from the 13th to 17th centuries as a confederation of merchant guilds and market cities banded together for commercial and defensive purposes. The cities not only shared armies, but also had their own legal systems. Prior to joining the League, many of these cities were already independent. Others gained independence through the League's collective bargaining power. That said, the League began to disband as individual cities started putting their self-interest first, and as the Swedish Empire and German princes gained power in the regions. So whether we're dealing with Michael Oliver, or Doug Casey, or Patry Friedman, this is him again, we can see attempts to realize political configurations that contest nation-state sovereignty, often seeking minimal forms of governance, sometimes providing only minimal protections and defense, that people can opt into and out of, voluntarily, as it were. In my opinion, what distinguishes Friedman's Seasteading Institute from past endeavors is how it leans on the early myths of the internet, namely of a space free from the creep of government, free for the expression of personal enterprise. I would argue that in these city building projects, we see the extrapolation of these myths onto physical space, productions of the virtual. Ironically, these productions are often driven by the very techno-libertarians whose free enterprise helped create the great monopolies of Web 2.0, which have effectively partitioned cyberspace. Now, I want to shift away from Seasted to talk about a concurrent movement to build cities in beleaguered nations, which is driven by Friedman, the NYU economist Paul Romer, and others. In my opinion, these cities are of much greater consequence than floating Seasteads in international waters. Paul Romer is largely considered to be the father of this movement. The economist took the stage at TED 2009 to announce his idea worth spreading, which he called charter cities. Let me walk you through Romer's thinking. Charter cities stem from his ideas from the 1990s that rules are the true linchpins of a given economy. The higher the quality of the rules, the more favorable the circumstances for investment, innovation, and economic growth. As an example, Romer considers Taiwan. If that country could develop with a scarcity of natural resources and capital goods, then some credit must go to the strength of its laws and customs. Romer's goal, in short, is to introduce good rules to countries with weaker ones. He believes that these rules can prove most effective when implemented on the scale of a city, not a country. That the city is an ideal platform for experimentation, a more flexible technology than the nation state. In this scenario, an agreement would be made with a weak-ruled country, allowing for the construction of charter cities or zones where these good rules could be put to use. As you might expect, Romer views good rules as those that allow for direct investment, avoid heavy regulation, and in general, minimize governmental control. Here we have the basic criteria of a charter city. Its zone remains the sovereign territory of the host country, but is privately held. As with Singapore, infrastructural and administrative costs are drawn from the revenues of land leasing and value gains. A given charter city sources its rules from a guarantor nation in the manner that Hong Kong recruits judges from common law jurisdictions, or Mauritius appeals cases to the United Kingdom's Privy Council. On Romer's recommendation, even security and defense can be contracted out to a guarantor nation. Romer's 2009 TED Talk proved a successful vehicle for his pitch. The footage ended up in the hands of the man on the right, Octavio Sanchez, who was chief of staff to then Honduran President Porfirio Lobo. Romer, it should be noted, is a famously cold and robotic speaker. And it was with great effort and coaching that his TED Talk made him seem half-human. So mere months after watching the talk, Sanchez flew Romer to Miami for a meeting with a Honduran Congress president on the left, and later to Tegucigalpa in Honduras for another meeting with Congress. In each case, Romer's presentation was interrupted, and Sanchez asked if they could just play his TED Talk instead. If you needed proof that TED is a consequential player on the global stage, this is it. Policy repackaged as 15 minutes of sound bites. But soon after Romer's second presentation at TED in 2011, an overwhelming majority of the Honduran Congress passed a constitutional amendment enabling the government to create Romer's cities in what they called special development regions. Now, Romer's nonprofit think tank, Charter Cities, maintains a strict conflict of interest policy in the city zones. He's not building the charter cities, but he's attempting to facilitate ties between potential charter citizens, charter courts, and charter investors. In March 2011, a public-private partnership agency was created, which signed non-binding memorandums of understanding with a handful of potential investors, including Future Cities Development Incorporated, created by Patry Friedman, and Free Cities Group, run by Kevin Lyons and Michael Strong. The website never stopped being under construction. Michael Strong, incidentally, runs another organization called Conscious Capitalism Incorporated, which believes that positive entrepreneurship can change the world. This is the logo and the central model of the Institute. Strong co-founded this organization with Whole Foods CEO John Mackey, shown here. How this ideal squares with city building is a question. Strong spoke at a Future of Free Cities conference in Honduras in 2011 and declared that his ultimate goal for these cities was to create anarcho-capitalist paradise. Anyways, Michael Strong's Free Cities group was a short-lived affair, and in 2013, Strong re-emerged on the Honduran scene in the guise of a new company, Grupo MGK. Grupo MGK was slated to build three city zones in these areas of the country, and for all intents and purposes, it seemed like the city building was underway. Now, theoretically, anyone in the world can migrate to a charter city. At TED 2009, Romer distributed the world's available arable land into a dotted grid. As you'll see from the bottom right image, we've only taken 3% of that available space. And cities for 1 billion new people, according to Romer, will only add a single percentage point more. Romer's is less radical than a techno-libertarian like Patrick Friedman, but the two would agree that we're living through the outmoding of existing governmental technologies. If a rising tide lifts all boats, then designing new urban platforms for free market enterprise should have a similar effect, even for the bottom billion. While Romer's techniques are neoliberal through and through, he is attempting to provide solutions for the imminent urbanization and global population crises. The 270 million people expected to move to Indian cities by 2013, the 700 million people that a Gallup poll recently shows want to migrate permanently. What you're looking at here is the UN's estimation of percentage growth rates of cities between now and 2025. In the interest of time, I'm not going to speculate about the many problems that could attend to these charter cities, because I'm sure you can imagine many of them. So let me cut to the end of this story about Honduras. Saskia Sassen has described a set of processes that do not necessarily scale at the global level, but which are a part of globalization. These non-cosmopolitan forms of global politics remain deeply attached to or focused on localized issues and struggles. The civic response to charter cities exemplifies these forms. In September 2012, over 70 challenges to the model cities were filed in Honduras. Among the numerous concerns was the effect of these cities on the Garifuna. The uninhabited land for Grupo MGK's first city happened to fall within this region, which 24 Garifuna communities considered a cultural sanctuary. This is the land in question. A month later, the constitutional law branch of the Supreme Court ruled against the city's constitutionality, with the argument that foreign investment implied the transfer of national territory. The Honduran Congress president responded by stating, "History will judge who sought jobs for Hondurans and who did not." Now, perhaps it speaks to my occasional pessimism about the future. When I began researching the Honduran project, I fully expected that at some point I'd see 3D renderings of these cities, visit their construction sites, be among the first to walk their extraterritorial avenues. That perhaps down the road I would return to find fresh walls built around these cities, surveyed by a private defense force. I would see these cities surrounded on all sides by informal settlements of aspiring residents, far more than could ever be housed within their walls, of workers given entry within contractually stipulated times, of migrants waiting for available jobs, waiting for the rising tide to lift their boats as well. I expected that these cities would follow this narrative thread, extreme examples of the effects brought on by increasing economic competition and resource management. But the narrative was cut short, and my project became an essay. Honduran civic protest overcame backroom governmental dealing. And since then, I've been trying to think about what lessons we can draw from this overturned future. Beyond the issue of neocolonialism, we could read the civic response as a rejection of the premise that individuals can assume their greatest liberty when the ethical and the political are bent to facilitate the exercise of economic agency, when government is minimized to a voluntary contract, when the free market frees you of everything, political rights and protections included. This is a cautionary tale, no doubt, but in conclusion, also a slightly hopeful one. So earlier in my discussion, I mentioned the Hanseatic League, a confederation of independent market cities that have their own legal systems and defense. In its extreme form, this is what charter and free cities aspire to stimulate, a new cosmopolitan network built on top of outmoded nation-state infrastructure. Elsewhere in the world, there are other large-scale experiments in city building, though at this point, nothing like a confederation or network has come into being. This brings me to my third project. You. Shortly before the passage of the constitutional amendment, a group of Honduran delegates visited Songdo, South Korea, and Singapore, the two places, Paul Romer claims, that are most keen on turning city building into a business. Songdo was developed in 2001 and is due for completion by 2020 after repeated delays in building out the master plan. The city is built on a landfill in the Incheon Free Economic Zone and has been promoted as the most ambitious instant city since Brasilia. So after finishing my essay on Honduras, I began researching Songdo. And I even spent 6 weeks living there in the summer of 2014. Songdo is an exemplary case of various forms of smart urbanism currently cropping up throughout the world. These are often called ubiquitous cities, and they're designed to be fully networked, fully in the cloud. One technology company made this childlike diagram of how such services would operate, which is ridiculous. The point, in short, is that the metropolis is being reconceived as an information network. Moreover, this network bears testament to a merger of big data and biopolitics on an unprecedented scale. As my colleague Ori Halpern has noted, these cities present the fantasy of managing life itself by bandwidth. This fantasy is not reserved to new master planned cities. Shown here is the operations center of Rio de Janeiro, the first citywide integrated data system in the world. The system was implemented in 2012 as part of IBM's Smarter Cities initiative, which sees a multi-billion dollar industry in bringing such operations to cities worldwide. Songdo, for its part, demonstrates a similar economic logic, serving as a functional model for cities as a service. Indeed, two of its partner developers, Boston real estate magnate Gale International and technology giant Cisco, have announced plans to introduce 20 Songdo-like cities across China and India, including this one in the Mexi Lake District in China. This is the proposed rendering. Who knows if it will be built? Cisco might be better known as the maker of telepresence technology, which it's implementing in apartments and offices throughout the city. I'm sure many of you are familiar with the principle of this corporation as offices in different cities, identical rooms designed in each city, equipped with these units, which are often a couple hundred thousand dollars, to create this trompe-l'oeil effect that you're sharing the room. So even before completing construction, Songdo has met financial challenges. It's failed to draw estimated foreign business, for example, despite the tax incentives. Journalists have reported on large numbers of empty storefronts, unused office space, and unoccupied apartments. The smart city, it would seem, is far from a proven model for 21st century urbanism, though it nonetheless signals an important shift in how we apply ideas of cognition, intelligence, feedback, and communication into our built environments. Before I went to Songdo in the summer of 2014, I bought a consumer Cisco telepresence camera. It was only $100, thankfully. I booked a night in this hotel, which overlooked Songdo's equivalent of Central Park. A locals mixer was being held in the hotel that night, so I went and talked my way into meetings with some of the people involved in the companies building the city. Eventually, I was able to interview people from most of the companies developing Songdo. Sometimes I Facebook stalked them. Sometimes I emailed them out of the blue. This is the view from my hotel room, to give you a sense. During my 6 weeks in Songdo, I stayed in the smart apartment run by the headmaster of a school that happened to have the largest telepresence unit in the city. There's some slowdown. Are you still hearing me? Thumbs up if so. Very good.
Yeah, it's all good.
Okay, good. It's just my PowerPoint has decided to freeze, so I'll just keep talking. So I might actually have to just close and open it up again. Just bear with me for a second. So the headmaster of the school itself had one of the largest telepresence units in the city, which I filmed with my telepresence camera. I made a deal with the landlord of a vacant skyscraper in the city. He would give me this office, which was slated for a bank that just decided to never arrive. And in return, I would make images of the skyscraper from the surrounding lots, which happened to be all overgrown fields. I'll show you that image in just a second. My presentation's back online. 1 second. And almost there. Okay, here we go. So, slideshow, setup show. Individual slideshow from current slide. All right, I'm turning it on again. All right, so that's the telepresence room. Here we have my office. and the photos I took. I also hauled my Cisco camera to every corner of the city, trying to imagine that I was facilitating an urban self-portrait, that in a city built of sensors and surveillance, there was some logic to surveying the surveyed, to meeting big data with small data, to generating an informational log outside of the proprietary domain of the technocrats. So what you're looking at is visual information feeding directly into my laptop. All of the stuttering and flashing are caused by the incapacity of my consumer camera to keep up with the high-definition data input. Now, there's something conceptually so satisfying about the idea of data capture as a form of urban self-portraiture, or as the automatic writing of the technology city. But for me, that conceptual satisfaction does not exactly carry through to what aesthetically is at hand. So this isn't material that I share except in talking about the project. But I did want to give you some images of what the city looks and feels like beyond what you'd normally encounter, beyond the renderings, beyond the newspaper-ready photographs. So in the projects I've described, there's a continual concern with giving people like the content farmer and the charter citizen actual positions within the fields of labor and politics, of grounding techno-futurist imaginaries in the lived, the physical, and the geopolitical conditions of the world. So in developing the Songdo project, I was also seeking a grounding position, a perspective that is intimately a part of the ubiquitous city, yet can critically comment on it. So on one hand, I'm thematizing telepresence as a reproductive logic of these cities. And on the other, I would argue that a city like Songdo should not be understood primarily as a built environment, but as a new type of sensorium, which has less to do with human sense than with what can be captured by data sensors, less with personal experience than ambient informatics. As with my content farmer, I wanted to imagine an extreme example of a person living in the smart city. So I turned to employees of the Integrated Operations Center, who were tasked to monitor all of the data coming in through the city's various cameras and sensors. I wondered, what is the sensory life of the person monitoring a sensor city? And on a broader level, what is the sensible life of a human living in the smart city sensorium? So at the end of my time in Songdo, I had the opportunity to visit this operations center, which is not open to the public. I sat with a governmental official in a small room overlooking this wall of screens. The room was filled with tiered seating designed so that visiting delegates from foreign nations could observe the center in operation, could see the test bed for the city they might want to replicate. I sat in the same seats where the Honduran delegates sat. And this is pretty much what I saw. During my visit, I gave questionnaires to the data monitors, asking them about sense experience and sense perception. What senses do they use most for their job? Which do they forget? Does the experience of doing this monitoring work change how they navigate the public spaces of the city? I also interviewed their supervisor, who told me that he was having a problem as monitors kept quitting. He attributed this to the fact that the job is quite boring. Monitors spend hours, even days, waiting for an accident, an emergency, or a crisis to happen, and they have to remain alert this entire time. So what's to be done to keep the monitors from quitting? The supervisor told me he was thinking about free gym classes, maybe therapy, which seemed amusingly anachronistic. Therapy in a futuristic city. I would expect neural reprogramming, but therapy. I left Songdo in July of 2014, and 3 months later, I began writing a script about group therapy sessions for big data monitors. I decided to model these sessions on Gestalt psychotherapy, which I believe has some similarities to big data monitoring. Gestalt is most often associated with this man on the left, Fritz Perls, who helped develop the technique in the 40s. The therapy focuses on the here and now, on what is apprehensible in the present moment through sense experience. Within this frame, the therapist is somewhat like a surveillance camera, scanning for shifts in the patient's body, language, and tone of voice. What we're looking at are video stills from a Gestalt demonstration that Perls conducted with college students. You'll note that there are seated figures in the foreground. Perls preferred group sessions, and he preferred having cameras present. This is another session at the Esalen Institute in California. Some of you might have seen footage like this in Adam Curtis's Century of the Self. You can see that one of the two cameras is in the corner of the room. So there's one other aspect of Gestalt therapy that's relevant to data monitoring. In a session, the therapist will ask the patient to assume the voices of the people, objects, and emotions in his or her dream. In this video, still a patient is describing a dream involving a Greek fountain. Pearl says, ask the woman to become the Greek fountain and address the other people in the room as the fountain. It's as ridiculous, strange, and affecting as it sounds. And the camera, like the therapist, keeps surveying. So I wrote and shot a script. I wrote a script and I ended up shooting it this past June. The video isn't set in Songdo, but it's based on my research there. I guess you'd call it a fictional work about a fictional smart city, a city that can replicate itself anywhere and that wants to be everywhere. So this will be the last part of the talk. I'll share a 5-minute video with you, and once you're done watching, we can discuss. The link's on the right. Thanks.
Sorry, it says it's private.
Yeah, the password is you. I wrote it right underneath.
I didn't see it. Just one word, one letter U, right?
Exactly. Very easy password.
Floor, my knees, floor.
So you're surveilling the floor. Feel a bit like a camera.
I think my mic is working now. Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah, I can hear you.
Yay!
What happened?
I just restarted my computer.
Okay.
Welcome back. Thank you. Yeah. All right. Everyone here?
I think Mo might still be watching. He seems to make his presence known, so.
I'm watching the film.
Okay. So we can chat in a sec. While I'm waiting, I'll send you a link to some images of the project as it's installed as well, so that you can get a sense of it. It's currently in an exhibition at the Kunstverein in Hamburg.
Done. Okay.
All right. And just to give you a general sense, the film in total is about 40 minutes long, and you watch the first 5 minutes of it. So it's sort of edited in this style. It takes place, it seems, over a couple of weeks. There are costume changes and a certain amount of narrative development that gets smuggled in. But the first third of the film, which is largely what you watch, is really about being thrown in media res into the technique and sort of learning about it. The second third of the film, it's much more about where they work and the labor that they do and like beginning to do some type of symbolic work around the city. And then in the third section, each character sort of has different ways of negotiating what's ultimately like a very complicated space, right? The sort of space of corporate therapy. being asked to disclose, right? And at the same time, not knowing to what extent what's happening is actually some type of job performance. So if any of you are interested, I'm happy to send you a link to the full film to watch. Just email me later. And for those of you who don't have it, here's my email address.
So should we start the Q&A?
That would be great.
Somebody wants to go ahead?
Actually, I thought maybe Margarita, maybe you can like ask some questions since you've been closer to the work. And, you know, what do you think?
I should confess that I still haven't watched the whole film of this later work, but something that I really like, and when we were going through these three projects, it's some, maybe my words are vague, but I like the...
Is your camera off or is it on?
It's on.
Do you want to turn it on and off, because for some reason your image is not being captured by the live video? But it could be just me who cannot see it, but...
I'm seeing her come through.
Oh, excellent. So it's just me. So never mind. Just if you can turn it on and continue on. Sorry about that.
I'm here.
I see you.
Okay, lovely.
I like this passage between the distribution of selves and the distribution of these disintegrated selves, or this kind of proto-artificial intelligence new beings, and the meta level of monetarization. So it's almost like there's a distributed artificial intelligence of these new humans that are being created in these, you know, offshore cities or in these specific self-contained capitalist enclosed temporary autonomous zones. No, this was the name that was coming back and back in my head. The crazy 90s writings of the Taz.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, of Hacking Bay. And then kind of the imaginal capacity and the techniques of recovering oneself through monetarization. Very Foucauldian in a sense. But maybe that's just a comment. I don't have a question. I don't know if somebody wants to build up on this and just we keep talking about the several layers of the work. I don't want to be the hierarchical voice here.
No. I mean, just to add to that, like in the sort of, you know, like standard media studies narrative, right? You have like the Foucauldian model, and then you have like Deleuze's postscript on societies of control. So this idea that like we internalize the policeman, right? We become our own cop or something. But in a lot of my projects, I'm very interested in like anachronism as well. Like I think it's super anachronistic to bring therapy into that operation center. I think it's like anachronistic to, in a certain way, to like write that book and like carry it into data centers to perform, you know. And a lot of the references in the book span like the Talmud to like early 18th century English literature. So for me, there is something about reclaiming Gestalt, which is what we might call like human-oriented object ontology, you know, something that is like hyper-anthropocentric, you know, but nonetheless has this premise of producing non-human subjectivity, which only belies the discovery of other parts of the self. So I wanted to put those things in relationship. So for me, like, as much as I have critiques of that city, I also didn't want to just stage a dystopia or like reproduce, let's say, what we might think of as an existing biopolitical narrative, you know. And so part of the attempt in the film was to actually like deal with characterization and have the characters negotiate the scenario in different ways. So like one character might have what we might think of as like a sort of standard alienation trajectory, you know. But because there are multiple narratives, it's not so cut and dry. It doesn't resolve itself in one didactic position, which was important to me, you know. Any other thoughts? Hey, Jesse.
Hi. I have lots of questions, and I really appreciated the overview. I looked a little bit at your work just before starting this, but it was nice to get kind of the overview, more of an overview of those pieces. So I really appreciate the way that you're able to kind of unfold some of these bigger questions around data, around monitoring, and technology without necessarily positioning it in this kind of moral stance. It seems like it's not, you know, this is good, this is bad, but rather kind of like approaching the complexity. And so my question, I guess, is for anyone, and it's kind of coming from a personal struggle, because I appreciate your work a lot, because I also kind of am bridging this space between like writing and making art, and so I do a lot of publications for philosophy kind of things and in pedagogy, and so you're able to speak a certain language and draw upon certain research and this kind of thing, and then the artwork can kind of be a refraction of that in a sense, or many, many things in relation to. But right now I'm doing an artist residency at a space where people are super interested in art, I guess, but not about, how can I say this? This is why I'm interested in this course. I guess how to approach these big questions without it becoming kind of this intellectual, or it's a question of access, I guess, because I think people can access ideas, not necessarily the ideas, but it's maybe the language or these kinds of things. So I'm working with people who are newcomers. I live in Canada, so I'm working with new immigrants to Canada, and they have amazing ideas. So many, I mean, we talk about amazing things in those close quarters, but then in the art making, I guess my own anxiety is like, what am I even doing? Like, is this just bullshit? Like, am I just like, I don't know. Is there a way to kind of bridge that that space of this like rhetoric and intellectual conversation, but still ideas that everyone deals with? It's not ideas themselves are not separate. That's a big question, and well, I don't expect you to provide me the end. What do I do? But
You asked it of all of us, because I've been talking a lot, I'm curious if other people actually have thoughts on it. I'm happy. I'll respond as well, obviously. But I think it's a pressing question that many of us have. So
yeah, so it's not necessarily just about your work.
But yeah, yeah.
The kind of bigger question.
Does anybody else want to weigh in?
I don't know. I'm interested in the whole scatological approach to writing that you take on, and how that can kind of, I don't know how that would work with what you're saying, Jesse, but just like the idea. Yeah, I don't know. I like the idea of like starting with a basic script or like these buzzwords, like in your first video, and then like having the viewer like perform it and kind of like fill in the spaces or the blanks, so that kind of like leaves room for agency and kind of like, I don't know, like the language needing to be performed in order to be accessed and kind of, I don't know. Maybe you could talk more about that, the whole like stream of consciousness kind of scatological approach to writing. I saw one of your other pieces a while ago where you did the whole, like, you walked throughout New York and, like, talked stream of conscious, and then, like, what did you, I forgot, you, like, transcribed it on, like, a scroll, or maybe, Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I can send a link to that. It's an old piece. It was a walking piece in the city, but it was actually that was a piece that it was a series of improvised monologues and conversations. Sometimes I would walk with other people across different city streets, but it was really actually trying to figure out like whether like what a mode of creative or let's say like non-productive walking could be in New York, given that like you know the 1811 commissioner's proposal, which defined the Manhattan grid, you know, effectively did so, and you see this in the language of the proposal, to like standardize valuation of property, right? To create certain standards of territorialization that, you know, that had clear economic incentives. So for me, it was like, how does one walk in a city? How does one walk like non-productively or like non-economically in a city that is premised in its form upon it? So so it wasn't as much about total improvisation, like I walked with notes for every street, and it was more about trying to find a sort of space between like responding to what's being given in the moment, but also thinking historiographically, basically suggesting that like, can you still hear me? Yes, okay. Basically suggesting that you can't just like superimpose the derive. You can't just superimpose a history of Flannery like onto New York. Like the city presents other like historical and economic circumstances that might merit different forms of mobility or something. But to go back to what you were saying about writing, and this also speaks to what Jesse was saying. I mean, I like when I was in college, like I was really like torn about whether I would get a PhD and whether I would go into art, and a very good friend of mine said that it really comes down to who you want to go to parties with for the rest of your life, and I thought that that was very wise. She chose the PhD, surprisingly, but nonetheless had this advice. But it's just to say, no offense to PhDs, I'm a researcher, but I think that the way that I go about research and the way that I enjoy research is I'm looking for stories, you know, and hopefully it's evident from the way that I even presented my projects, you know. I really enjoy the opportunity to speak publicly about the work because there are circumstances when I can actually introduce this level of narrative that it's hard to sometimes access in the immediate project. So I guess my answer to you, Jesse, is more like I've come over the years. It's like you struggle with like what seem to be the sort of ready-made containers of how you are supposed to fit or perform or how language is supposed to perform itself professionally. And hopefully in that time you develop a sense of your temperament, like your own intellectual ceiling and limitations as a thinker or writer, and allow the temperamental aspects of your sort of like aesthetic intellectual interest to actually drive you. And so for me, like a lot of my 20s was really spent coming to terms with like the weird way that I'm like a human / creative practitioner in the world and starting to identify those things as strengths, you know. So some of the ways that I was writing, which just felt like nothing, I began to take seriously and imagine as other registers of producing language, you know. So if anything, like my aversion is twofold. One, like I'm not a macro theoretical thinker, you know. I can start on a large scale and like read Keller Easterling or read Halpern or whatever like on these topics, but I'm ultimately don't feel like I'm professionally or otherwise equipped to speak on that scale. I'm much more interested in beginning on that scale and then, as Brian Holmes would say, doing the sort of empirical research, you know, and trying to find something smaller within that. And I guess the other thing that I've come to recognize, and this goes back to the Goldsmith thing, is that like I am still interested in authorship, right? Or I am interested in giving voice as part of my practice. And sometimes I might not be the speaker. Sometimes some of the language might be ready-made in a sense. But these are sort of where my identifications and affiliations have landed, you know. So I don't know what your temperament is, Jesse, as a writer, maker, thinker, or what the temperaments of the rest of you are, but I often find, like, you know, if you make, and it takes time, right, but if you sort of, like, it's almost like a parallax shift, like, just to the side of what seems to be the models to fill, you know, you can perhaps see, like, ways in which you can actually approach different modalities of writing and making and thinking askance, you know, and perhaps from a from territory that is more your own and less prescribed or pre-given.
Thank you. Yeah, I the first word I used to describe myself is a teacher, because I actually, my background is in pedagogy and at a university in the education department, so teaching future teachers. And so for me, pedagogy is part of my practice as well. And that's why I appreciated, again, the kind of like your ability to weave all of these kind of complex things together to create that narrative, but not a typical narrative. Yeah, that was just a question to see what people were thinking and feeling, I guess, about art. I guess I'm just having some questions about art these days, like in general, like why should I be making art? But that's my own issue. So I'll turn it over to someone else if someone else has a question.
Can you guys